I have disabled the participant annotations. How are you able to write after I've disabled it? Very fast. You're very fast. Good afternoon, guys. Okay, I've disabled the participant annotations. All right. Okay. So today's class, in fact, this entire week we'll be covering two modules. Good afternoon, good evening, everyone. So all of you are able to hear me? I'm assuming all of you are able to hear me. Yes. Okay. Cool. So now that, okay, all of you are able to hear me. Good, good, good. So yes, today's class we are going to cover grammar basics. Okay, and in this grammar basics, actually, we are going to go very in depth. One reason is I've seen a lot of people in this particular class, in this particular chat group, that how do I put? Language originated out of logic. Okay. Yes, you can send messages to me. I am the host, so I think you can send messages to me. Yes. Okay. There are a few. Who is that? I don't see anyone who is waiting to accept Nanna Aditya. Abhi, I'll post the answer sheet on the Aptitude Experts website, Nanna. But for now, let me talk to you about grammar. So listen, so the way grammar works is very, very simple. Language was originated out of grammar. Grammar did not originate out of language. We decided that, okay, this is a particular logic in which we want to speak. Okay. And then we decided, okay, then this will be a rule. We did not, you know, make rules first and then come to grammar. In fact, English grammar is very, very weird, to be very honest. Okay. There are some rules which has a lot of exceptions rather than the accepted cases. Okay. Anyways, when we are talking about grammar, we are talking about all the logics of making the proper sentences. Okay. Now, all of you people who are feeling that your English is not very good, who are feeling that you're not able to speak confidently in English, this is your masterclass. Okay. If you start with this class, then 90% of your, you know, day-to-day activities of English will become very easy. You will be able to speak fluently in English. You'll be able to read English better and understand the English, you know, structure better. Because 90% of time you guys complain about we don't know the meaning of this particular word, no? And as I've told you in the reading comprehension classes, we should be trying to understand the meaning of a word contextually. And how do you understand meaning of those words contextually? You will be able to understand the meanings of those words contextually only if you are able to understand the structure of the sentence. Okay? If you understand that, yes, I have written a sentence till this part and the next part should be like this. You should get that kind of a thought in your mind when you're writing English. Okay? Now, where will this help you? This will help you in my next module, which is sentence correction module, which will be a part of your CRT exams. Okay? This will also help you in your professional writing module, where I'll be teaching you how to write business letters. Okay? I'll be teaching you how to write letters to attract media attention. I'll be teaching you how to write informal and formal communiques. Communiques are again newsletters. Okay. I'll be teaching you what are articles. I'll be teaching you what's a journal entry. I will also be teaching you how do you properly document or record observations. Okay. All this comes under your business communication course. All right. Now, apart from that, where else does this add value? This week, this entire week from today, that is Monday till Saturday, I have planned 6 classes for you, and these 6 classes are going to be 4 of grammar and 2 of resume writing and professional writing. In resume and professional writing, I'll be teaching you the different formats of a resume. I'll be showing you a few example resumes with the shared screen, and you'll be constructing your own resume this week. Okay. Apart from that, we'd also be learning what are cover letters, why did we ever used to write cover letters, and do we have to write cover letters anymore? Okay, since nowadays 90% of you are getting placed through campus, cover letters are a thing of obsoleteness. Okay, they've become utterly useless. But in case you ever want to apply, you know, off campus, if you ever want to apply to any other company off campus, then you must write a cover letter along with your CV and post it to them. Okay, so I'll be teaching you all the nuances of cover letters. And once this module is over, we'll go back to reading comprehensions for 1 to 2 days. Okay, so that you can apply all the things that you have learned in these classes onto your reading comprehensions as well. Are we clear? Is this module clear to you? Guys? Okay. So let's go with the first part. As I told you, I'll be teaching you what sentences are. Now, you guys can take a screenshot of my screen and save it up with you, or I will be uploading this entire PPT as a PDF, just like every day. Okay. So try to focus and keep engaging with me on an intellectual level, as in keep asking your doubts through the group chat. In grammar classes, especially, I will be more than happy to clear as many doubts of the students as possible. Okay. So if you have even a minute doubt, please type it up. All right. Okay. Now, when we speak or write words, right? We write these words in groups or sets. Yes. So should I always think that a sentence is always a group of words? Does that always make sense? Should I always refer to a sentence as a group of words only? Because sometimes when I say run, right? This run is also a sentence, no, for me? Yes. Or if I say help, this help also is a sentence to me, no? Correct? So why can one word not be a sentence? So technically speaking, even one word can be a sentence, correct? Is that right or no? Yes or no? Okay. So you guys say yes. All right. There's someone who, Mahesh, you say no. Okay. Good. Now, fine. Let me just pause this over here and let me go further. Okay. I'll explain to you why this one word is not a sentence for sure. Okay, I'll explain to you why run is not a sentence, why help is not a sentence. Okay, that is because in every kind of a sentence, we have two things that we have to always look for. Okay, there's two parts in every kind of a sentence. First part should be someone that we are talking about or something we are talking about. And second part is something we are telling about that person. For example, if I say Ramakrishna is a student of GVP. Okay. Now in this sentence, whom am I talking about? I am talking about Ramakrishna, correct? Yes. And what am I telling about Ramakrishna? I am telling that Ramakrishna is a student of GVP. So this is your first part. And this is your second part. Am I correct? So when we are saying that every sentence should have two parts, how does the sentence run have two parts? Or how does the sentence help have two parts? They don't have two parts, no? Am I correct or no? So that means run, help, these should not be sentences. Yes. But think about it in this way. Let us say that you are on the street and you know, a dog is chasing you. What will I say? I will say run. Yes. Okay, someone saying, sir, talking about a person or saying something about that person is the same, right? Well, yeah, talking about the person or saying about the person is same as in, okay. The first part is someone we talk about, okay? When I'm saying we talk about some person or something, I'm not talking about this talk part. I'm saying about person. I am indicating person or thing. Okay, PSS Prithvi Raj. Okay, that is what I mean. So Ramakrishna is the person I am talking about. Nenu evari gurinchi aithe maatladutunano adi first part nanna. Okay, I'm sorry, I can't write Telugu, I can only speak Telugu, but yeah, nenu evari gurinchi aithe maatladutunano adi first part nanna Ram Prithvi, and nenu vaalla gurinchi edaithe cheptunano adi second part nanna. ठीक है, सो मैं जिनके बारे में बात कर रहा हूँ वो फर्स्ट पार्ट है, और मैं उनके बारे में जो बोल रहा हूँ वो सेकेंड पार्ट हो जाएगा. ओके, ऑलराइट, गुड. एनीवेज या महर, दिस इज नॉट अ वन वर्ड सब्स्टिट्यूट करना, वन वर्ड सब्स्टिट्यूट्स आर एक्सट्रीमली डिफरेंट. ओके, बट लेट मी एक्सप्लेन यू व्हाई दिस हैपेंस, एंड टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाई दिस हैपेंस, ओके, वी नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट काइंड्स ऑफ सेंटेंसेस. All right. Now, we have four different types of sentences. All right. And I want you to carefully note the punctuation marks at the end of all these four types of sentences. Okay. Now, the first type of sentence is a declarative or an assertive sentence. Okay. Now, what is a declarative or an assertive sentence? A sentence that makes a statement. A sentence that makes a statement or assertion is called as declarative or assertive statement. Now, to be very simple, if I make a statement, if I have any statement, okay, either if it is a positive statement or a true statement, or if it's a negative statement or a false statement, it will be an what? Assertive sentence. Okay. For example, New Delhi is the capital of India. Is that correct? Obviously, yes. So that is an assertive statement. If I tell you Pradi sir is teaching you quant, that's a false statement, no? But still, it's a statement that you're making, no? So that is going to be an assertive statement only. Am I clear? So did all of you understand what is assertive statements? All right. So any statement that you can answer with a true or false becomes an assertive statement. Now, why is it that we even use sentences here? First of all, what is the need for me to have sentences? See, we use sentences for good question. Someone, the message went up. I'm sorry, I didn't see your name. But yeah, good question. So, see, the reason why we use sentences is very simply to communicate with each other. See, if you don't use sentences, how will you express your thoughts? How will you tell your ideas to other people? Huh? So, in retrospect, not so good a question. Not really a great question. But okay, whatever. See, we use sentences to express our thoughts, to make sure that our ideas are moving from us to other people. Okay, to just put out our ideas, we will be using sentences. Now, we have different types of ideas, no? So each type of idea that we are using, we can classify it into a different type of sentence. So first type of sentence is your declarative or assertive sentence. Now, if my idea is to question you about something, okay, if my idea is to ask you a question about something, then that will be an interrogative sentence. Okay, then that will be an interrogative sentence. Like, where do you live, including the question what's up. Okay, all of these sentences are interrogative sentences. Is that clear? Okay. Now, The third type of sentence that we can, you know, look at is known as an imperative sentence. Now, this imperative sentence is extremely important for you to understand, because 90% of the confusion will happen in these imperative sentences only. When you're trying to write an imperative sentence, you should be very, very cautious about how to take the sentence forward, okay? And if you are expressing a command, like, shut the door, okay? Or maybe you are expressing a command to a race team, okay? Maybe there are six different racers in a race team, and you are saying, run, okay? These will be commands. But try to observe carefully. Try to observe carefully. When I am saying New Delhi is the capital of India, can I say New Delhi is my person or the thing that I am talking about? Yes. And I am telling all of this about Delhi. Correct? Now, when I'm saying, where do you live? Can I say, I am talking about you? Yes, I am talking about you. Yes. And what am I asking about you? I'm asking your location. Correct? But what happens when I'm saying run? Whom am I telling this run? Now, over here, what is happening is, it's always a direct speech. For example, if I am here, I see a dog over here. I can't draw a dog this fast, but okay. And let us say you are over here. Okay? And I say, run. If you turn to me and ask, sir, that's not a sentence, I won't run, then it's a big problem for you. But in this case, we understand that whatever I'm speaking, I'm only speaking to you. So this sentence properly should be, you run. Right? Yes? For example, if I'm saying, help. What should be the proper sentence? It should be, you help. And whom will you help? Will you help the other guy? No. You will say, you help me. Correct? So Varun Kumar is asking, sir, if we say, hey, run, is it a sentence? There is a first and second. Okay, again, Varun, when you're saying, hey, run, who is that hey? Varun, who is that hey? Hey is going to be some person, no? So that person's name is going to become your subject, Varun. Right, yeah. Someone may be Varun or name, right? So that person, that name or Varun becomes your subject, Kanna. So that is your first part. Yeah, you can say, hey, you run. Monica, you can say, hey, you run. But again, why would you want to add that hey over there? Sai Durga and Soumya. You guys are asking me the meaning of the word entreaty, right? Entreaty is a formal word for humble request. Okay, entreaty means request, Nana. Chala vinayam toti koodi request cheste danni entreaty antaru. Okay, alright. Yeah, so anyways, so now do you understand? Is you help me a proper sentence? Yes, you help me is a proper sentence. But 90% of the times in these days, we are not using that complete sentence at all. Okay. And why is it okay for us to leave this part of you? Come on, think about it. When you help me is the proper sentence, why is it that I'm leaving out you and me in the sentence? Why am I saying only help? Okay. I am saying help, only help, because it is a direct communication. Look at that small picture that I drew over here. Only I am here and you are here, no? There's no one else, right? So we both know that I'm speaking only to you. So I don't need to again tell you run, right? So since imperative sentences, which are commands, requests, these are all 90% of time direct speeches, we don't need to use the subject. So subject can be omitted in an imperative sentence. Okay, Divakar, thank you so much. Okay, anyways, let's move on to exclamatory sentences. Yes. Now, what's an exclamatory sentence? Exclamatory sentence is a sentence that expresses any strong feeling. How cold the night is. Okay. Okay. This is a very poetic way of saying it, that the night is very cold. Okay. Now, the problem over here is when you say the night is very cold. Okay, when you say the night is very cold, this sentence without this exclamation, if I put a full stop, will become an assertive sentence. Okay, because you can either say the night is, yes, the night is cold, or no, the night is not cold. No, are you able to understand? So only because of this punctuation, I'm able to actually differentiate. Okay. All right. Did you guys understand the different types of sentences? Could you please send me the document to my mail? Pratyush is an interrogative sentence. It's not an imperative sentence. Because the answer of that could be yes, I can, or yes, I can't. Right? So when I'm able to answer that sentence, it's going to be an imperative sentence. Now, instead of saying, could you please send me, had you told me, please send me, that would have become an imperative sentence. All right, Pratyush? Run. It is an imperative sentence, Tana. Jami Shushmita, run is an imperative sentence. Okay. All right. So can we move forward? All right. So here. So what if there's an exclamatory mark at the end of the sentence? It still does not matter. It still does not matter because it's not expressing any kind of your emotion. Jhansi Sai Sindhura, I don't know what exactly your name is, but it's not going to be an exclamatory sentence, even if there's an exclamatory mark right after run, because it's not expressing a strong emotion. Okay. All right. So can I move forward? If you have any more doubts, I'll actually give you like two minutes. Type in all your doubts. Yeah, it's okay. The time on my watch is 4:00. Take 2 minutes, type in all your doubts. It's completely fine. Your question was not about run. Okay, so okay, your question generally was, what if there's an exclamatory mark at the end of the sentence? Okay, what if there's no exclamatory mark at the end of the sentence? Well, then it's not an exclamatory sentence. I didn't understand your question. Can you please type your question again? Don't worry, I will wait for you, but please type in your question again. Okay, in the meantime, let's look at how do we say what's a strong emotion and what's not? So when I say strong emotion, any emotion that you're expressing is a strong emotion. I'm hungry, okay, is an exclamatory sentence. All right. It doesn't matter if you're famished or if you're starving or if you're just hungry. All the three of these will be an exclamatory sentence. So briefly explain last 10 minutes topic due to some net issues. Okay. So Jhansi, don't worry. See, all that I've done is just explain you what sentences are. Okay. I will be uploading this PPT again. So if you have any doubt, you can just text me about it. Don't worry. What's the exact difference between an imperative and an interrogative sentence? Well, see, imperative sentences are commands. Interrogative sentences are questions. Okay. For example, if I'm saying, please close the door. I am telling you should do that. If I say, Shriram, close the door, dude. Okay. That means Harichanna, close the door. If I tell that, it'll be like, you know, you have to close the door, no? But if I ask you, Harichanna, can you please close the door? Or can you close that door? I'm questioning your ability. No, maybe you can, maybe you can't. For example, if I tell you, Harichanna, please lift that 80 kgs weight. you will have to go, you will have to try. But if I tell you, hey, Harishanna, can you lift 80 kgs weight? Then that is asking your ability, you know? So I'm only questioning you. Have a good day. Well, have a good day is going to be an assertive sentence, Nana. Because it's a general fact, no, it's a general thing. Now, Sriram, if I say please close the door and you say no, that is awfully rude of you. But it still is going to be an imperative sentence only. Okay? Surya Manisha, from next time, type the whole message to together because other people are sending a message and your message is like, you know, broken into parts. Right? Aray, look, the sun is rising in the east. Wow. First of all, aray is not an English word, Surya Manisha. So don't use that in your sentences. Look, the sun is rising in the east will be a kind of, what is this, assertive sentence. No, actually, wait, 1 minute. That's going to be an imperative sentence. Okay? I am hungry. I am hungry. So can this sentence be an assertive sentence? Well, look, it's again, to be very honest, it's your feeling, right? So it should be an imperative sentence. How can we say if a sentence is assertive or explanatory? Asha, you'll have to go through the slides again. Once, just go through the slides again. Does universal truth also? Yes, yes, yes. All the universal truths come under assertive sentences. Okay, all the universal truths come under assertive sentences. Wishes come under imperative sentences. Wishes come under imperative sentences. Yes. Are you understanding the class? That will come under interrogative sentences. No, close the door, there's no emotion in that. Okay. Close the door is just a demand. Okay. All right. Anyways, now, so remember in a sentence, I told you that there are two parts that I'm going to talk about. First part is something or some person's name. Correct? So this part is known as your subject. Okay? And the second part that we are talking about is what we are saying about them. Okay, it's what we are saying about them. Now, whenever we are saying this word, to say, is known as a predicate. Okay, so this part is known as the predicate. The second part is known as the predicate of the sentence. Is that clear? All right. Now, usually the subject of the sentence will come first. Okay? But sometimes we'll have to put the predicate before. In very rare cases, for example, if I say, here comes the bus. Okay? In January, all of us play, we fly kites, right? So if I say, there goes my kite. Now here, whom am I or what am I talking about? I'm talking about kite, no? I'm telling my kite is gone, no, somewhere. So this should be my subject, no? And this will become my predicate. So there are very rare cases in which I'll be putting the predicate before the subject. Otherwise, 99.99% of times, I'll be putting the subject first and then predicate. Is that clear? Are all of us clear with that? Okay. All right. Let's move forward. Now, the next topic that I'm going to go forward with is called as parts of speech. And before I start this parts of speech, I'll give you 3 minutes. The time in my watch is 4:07. So I'll give you a time till 4:10. Please type in all the doubts you have about the previous topic. Because once we move to parts of speech, I would like to take doubts on parts of speech. Okay? So please take 3 minutes and type down all the doubts that you have on sentences. Are you enjoying the class? Is an interrogative sentence. Nana, Harichandana. Durga Bharadwaj, which example are you talking about? Are you talking about this one? The subject one? Yeah. Okay, I'll explain it to you again. Don't worry. So see, usually when I'm saying bus is here. Now, what am I talking about? I'm talking about bus, not Durga. Should I call you Durga or Bharadwaj? What's your name? Anyways, okay, I'll just call you Durga. Anyways, so the bus is here, right? Okay, in that, bus is the subject because that's what I'm talking about. Yes? And then I am telling something about it, where it is. So this becomes the predicate. Right? Now, if I say New Delhi is India's capital, I'm talking about New Delhi. And I am telling something about New Delhi. Correct. So in all these things, we are talking about subject first. We are putting subject first and then predicate. Okay. But only very rarely we have to put the subject at the end. Okay. Nana, assertive or assertion is to put a statement, is to put forward a statement. Madhuri. Okay, not Madhuri, it's someone else. I'm sorry. Oh shit. Okay, 1 minute. Give me 1 minute. I don't know who sent that message. A lot of messages are popping up. Anjali, sorry. Yeah. Madhuri, you asked me if we talk about time, is it assertive? How do you mean? Are you telling the time is 6:30? Yes, that is assertive. Okay. He is my friend. Here, he is the subject. To be honest, yes, he is the subject, but he is a part of speech known as pronoun. Okay. Here comes the bus. That's an assertive sentence. Hello world. Well, shut the door. Could you please shut the door? Yes, both of these are imperative sentences. The first one is a command. The second one is a request. Tarun, you are asking, here comes the bus. I just said, right? Here comes the bus is going to be an assertive sentence. New Delhi is India's capital. Why can't India be taken as subject? Because we're not talking about India. Now, if I tell you, your name is something. Whose name am I talking about? Your name. No, so your will be the subject, right? Okay. Now, Sirisha, you ask, Praddy sir is explaining verbal class. In this, Praddy sir is the subject? Yes, Praddy is the subject. Keep quiet, won't you? Which type of sentence that is? That's going to be an interrogative sentence, no? Because you're questioning him. Okay? All right. Any more doubts? Well, you don't need to exactly know which type of sentence it is as long as you're able to use the sentences properly. But if you are attempting any exam like the CAT, GRE or GMAT, yes, it's extremely important for you to know what type of sentence it is. Okay. All right. Let's move forward. Okay. Now, there are 8 parts of speech. All right. And in today's class, we'll attempt to learn about the nouns. Now, to be very, very, very simply put, okay, I will just give you a very brief flow of the nouns, and then we will be learning the nouns in a much detailed manner in the further classes. Okay, So all of you, I would want you guys to take out your notes and copy this flowchart that I'm making for you. Okay. So keep quiet. Keep quiet is going to be what do you call this? Imperative sentence, Kana, Durga Bharadwaj. Harshita, which part are you asking about? I'm not sure of your question. Is my voice audible now? Karthik, are you able to hear me now? Because you're requesting people to keep quiet, no? Durga, if you're saying keep quiet, you're requesting people. So it's an imperative sentence. Okay, anyways, guys, please take out a run fast, else you'll miss the bus is also going to be imperative. You're commanding them. Oh, no. What type of sentence is no? It's going to be an assertive sentence. Vivek Patnaik, I'm sorry, I did not receive your message earlier. Karthik, it's still not audible. My voice is still not audible. It's high time is also an assertive sentence because you're asserting that it's high time, no? You're basically telling me it's high time, right? Yeah, okay. All right. Anyways, guys, let's go to nouns. It's been really high time. We've taken a lot of time to just cover sentences. We have hardly 15 minutes left in this class. So, yeah, here. Nouns are divided into three types, Nana. First one, okay, is about a function. Second one is about the gender in which they are there. Gandhi, this Yernama, you're late to class, what type of sentence is that? Well, it depends on where you're using it, but it's going to be an assertive sentence. Okay, so function, gender, and case. These are the three types of demarcations we're going to make in nouns. Okay, now all the other doubts, please redirect it to my WhatsApp. Of this class, I have another two classes and I'll finish them and I'll just clear your doubts, okay? So anyways, please focus on the nouns part of this class, okay? In function, we again have six different types, okay? Depending on the function, we again have six different types of nouns. First one is called as a proper noun. Second one is common noun, okay? Third one is going to be a collective noun. Okay. Fourth one, an abstract noun. Fifth one we are going to have is something called as a countable noun. And sixth one will be uncountable noun. Depending on the gender, we have four types again. We have the masculine nouns, we have feminine nouns, okay? Then we have common gender nouns, and we have neuter gender nouns. Depending on the case, we have three demarcations. We have a subjective case, we have an objective case, and we have a possessive case. Okay, is that all right? Now, what are all these things if you're asking me? It's very, very simple. First of all, let us try to understand, because we have already understood what a subject is, what an object is, or what a subject is. Let me first try to tell you what is an object of the sentence. Okay. I think in this class, we won't be able to cover a lot of grammar, but that's okay. We still have four modules, so yeah, I'll try to cover up the next module a little quicker. Okay, so let us say I eat a veg burger. Okay, why veg burger? No reason. My love, my rules. Okay, but anyways, yeah. So here, if I'm eating veg burger, I am the subject of this sentence, correct? Yes. And what am I doing? And what am I telling in this sentence? I'm telling that I am eating a veg burger. So can I say that this is the subject, and this whole thing becomes the predicate? This is what I'm telling about me, no? Correct? Okay. But if I ask you the question, because of me eating, that means because of me doing the action, where can I see the influence? I can see the influence on burger. Correct? I can see the influence on burger. Obviously, you know, if I'm eating, the burger size will reduce, no? Yes? So, always remember, because of the subject performing an action, there we can see the influence. That word is known as the object. Okay, so because of the subject performing any action, where we can see the influence, that word is known as the object. Is that clear? So here in this sentence, what will happen? It'll be veg burger. Okay? Is that clear? Are all of us clear about this? Okay, now that you know what is an object, I'll feel much clearer, I'll feel much confident going into the theory of your nouns. Okay? Let me start off nouns today because we still have good enough time. Okay? And we'll take it up from there in the next class. That's not going to be an issue at all. So, very specifically, very easily speaking, a noun is a word, you know, that's used as a name of anything. To be very honest, I want you guys to remember noun equals to name. Whose name? It does not matter. I don't know your name. I am giving you a name that is going to be a noun. For example, I don't know your name. And who texted me recently? Chandra. Okay. If I give you the name Chandra, okay, I am only giving this name to one person, correct? Yes. Or even if 5-6 people have this name, when I'm using this name, I'm calling only one person with this particular name, correct? So this name or this name I am giving to one proper person. So this will become a proper noun. Am I clear? Yes? Are you guys able to understand? Now, if I say that there is Chandra, there is Anjali, there is Charan, there is other people also on this chat, okay? And all of you are studying. All of you are studying. So, if I'm giving any particular name to all of you together, like all the students say yes. Now, this is for all of you together. And why am I calling you students? Because you have one common quality. What is that common quality? That common quality is that you guys are studying. So if I'm giving the name to a common quality, if I'm giving a name to a common quality, I will call it as a common now. Am I clear? All right. Now, you can look at the examples over here. Just give me 1 minute. I'll get some water for myself. These are the examples. In the meanwhile, please take a look at this slide. I'll be back in a while. Okay, all right. Now, if I take a lot of people, like let us say there can be one class, let us say section A, okay, that has 100 students. Okay, I have section B with 200 students. And then I have section C with 3 students. You expected 300, no? No. Okay. And then I have section C with 3 students. Okay. Now, all of these are students. And I just told you that student is a common noun. But for all these 200 students together, I am giving them one name, no? What is that name? Section B. So this section B is the name I'm giving to the collection, correct? That section B is the name I'm giving to the collection. That is why this section B will become a collective noun. Is that clear? All right. Now, just like that, if we are looking at this collective noun army, okay, I can say that everyone, anyone who is protecting my country is a soldier. Okay, now there can be 100 soldiers in an army, you know. Let us say Indian army. Okay, in Indian army there are 100 soldiers. Now, the soldier will be a common noun, army will be a collective noun. Is that clear? Okay. Next part, we'll be talking about abstract noun. Now, what is an abstract thing or an abstract quantity? Sir, school is what type of noun? Depends on how you are using school. If you can tell me the sentence in which you're using school, then only I can tell you what type of noun it is, Mama. KVS Chaitanya, was I audible to you? KVS Chaitanya? Okay, all right. So you just tell me the sentence and then I'll tell you which type of a noun it is. Okay, anyways. Now, when I'm talking, a group of fishes called school. In that case, school is a collective noun. Okay, if I'm telling that a group of fish is called school, that in that case, school is a collective noun. Now, abstract noun. What is an abstract noun? When I cannot exactly show you that per thing, or when I cannot exactly see that thing, I can only feel that thing. It's called as an abstract noun. For example, if you have a severe pain in your stomach and after you eat some food, that pain is gone. Then what is that pain? That pain is called hunger, no? But can you show me hunger? No. So that part, that feeling that you are having, you don't know what it is if you don't give it a name, no? ఇప్పుడు దానికి ఆకలి అని మీరు పేరు ఇవ్వకుండా దానికి ఏమో దాహం అని మీరు పేరు ఇచ్చారు అనుకోండి అది దాహం అయిపోతుంది కదా ఇఫ్ యూ టెల్ మీ దట్ హంగర్ ఇస్ నాట్ హంగర్ ఇట్ ఈస్ థర్స్ట్ సో ఫ్రమ్ టుడే ఇఫ్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ అస్ సే దట్ వెన్ ఎవర్